From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinion featured in JAMA.
Hello, and welcome to this episode of JAMA Author Interview Podcast. I'm John Inadomi, Chair of the Department of Intern Medicine for the University of Utah, and Associate Editor of JAMA. I'm joined today by Dr. Gil Kaplan, Professor of Medicine at the Cumming School of Music at the University of Calgary. Dr. Kaplan is an internationally renowned gastroenterologist with a research and clinical focus in the care of patients with inflammatory bowel disease. He's a fellow of the Canadian Academy of Health Sciences, and we're here to discuss a paper published in JAMA, for which he wrote the editorial, about a randomized clinical trial of risankizumab for induction and maintenance in patients with moderate to severe ulcerative colitis by Lewis and others. Gil, welcome to JAMA Podcast.
Good morning, John. Thank you so much for having me on today.
Great. You know, there's steroids, there's 5-ASAs, TNF-alpha inhibitors, small molecules, starting JAK. You know, why do we need more drugs for ulcerative colitis?
Yeah, it's a great question. And despite advances to medical management, a whole series of new cadre of medications that we have to treat ulcerative colitis, you know, we're still in a position where if you look at somebody diagnosed with ulcerative colitis, 5 years later, 1 in 5 of them are still hospitalized, and approximately 7% still need colectomy. Moreover, people with ulcerative colitis who are flaring, you know, they're experiencing really severe symptoms, abdominal pain, diarrhea, rectal bleeding, having a huge impact on their quality of life. And so it's really important for us to try to get the right therapies for them to get them better. And generally, when we think about the goal of medical management of ulcerative colitis, it's twofold. First, we want to prescribe medications that induce remission. So people have active inflammation, they get into remission and they're feeling well. And then the second goal is to use medications to maintain that remission to prevent reactivation of inflammation. And again, when we start to think about what the choices we are to treat somebody for induction and maintenance, the number one factor that we look at is the disease severity at the time that they're flaring. And people who have mild disease, you know, we often will use 5-aminosalicylates, mesalamine-based products. That's essentially our first-line therapy to treat mild to moderate ulcerative colitis. And those drugs are actually very effective for that treatment group. But there's a subset of our patients with ulcerative colitis that have moderate to severe disease activity. And that's either recognized because they fail to respond to 5-aminosalicylates, or just when we're evaluating initially with, for example, with endoscopy, their disease activity is quite high. So in those situations, we need to manage them with more advanced therapies that really focus on targeting the pathogenesis of ulcerative colitis. And this is actually a really exciting area of treating ulcerative colitis because the FDA has approved a whole series of different classes of medications to treat that moderate to severe ulcerative colitis. And that treatment has evolved from thiopurines like azathioprine to using biologics, monoclonal antibodies that target TNF-alpha like infliximab and adalimumab that target alpha-4 beta-7 integrins like vedolizumab. We have monoclonal antibodies that target IL-12 and 23, that's ustekinumab. And then these newer therapies that target just IL-23, such as mirankizumab and risankizumab. In addition to that, more recently, we've developed a whole series of oral small molecules that either focus on JAK inhibitors like upadacitinib and tofacitinib, or S1P receptor modulators like ozanimod and etrasimod. And the reason I bring out all of these different drugs is just to give the audience a flavor that we have lots and lots of different choices to treat this moderate to severe ulcerative colitis. And in fact, the newest FDA-approved treatment for ulcerative colitis is risankizumab, which we'll be discussing today. But going back to your original question of why we need more drugs, is that despite all these different classes of medication, there's no single drug that achieves a highly effective and durable response over time for all people living with ulcerative colitis. So we continue to struggle with what are the best treatments for people with ulcerative colitis.
Thanks for that overview. So before we talk about the study itself, what's different about risankizumab and why do we think it would work when other therapies don't work?
Yeah, you know, one of our advanced kind of thinking about ulcerative colitis is that we kind of don't even think about it necessarily as a single disease. It's actually multiple different immunological diseases that different parts of the immune system are acting towards. And the reason why that concept is really important is because when you have different parts of the immune system actively involved in causing inflammation, ulcerative colitis, some drugs might work for some people, other drugs work for other people. And by understanding the pathogenesis of ulcerative colitis, we've been able to develop monoclonal antibodies and drugs that work on different pathways. And so specifically, I'll give you one example. One of the critical pathways is the Th17 pathway. And that differentiation of a naive T cell to that Th17 T cell pathway that leads to inflammation and ulcerative colitis is mediated by the cytokine IL-23. And the very first drug that was developed to block IL-23 was ustekinumab. And it targets specifically the P40 subunit that is expressed both on IL-12 and IL-23. Now, a newer class of biologics was designed to block the P19 subunit, which is only blocks IL-23, so leaving that IL-12 pathway alone. And so this is where this newer class of medications was approved. The very first one that was approved for ulcerative colitis was mirikizumab, and then risankizumab, which we'll talk about now, is just recently approved for ulcerative colitis, but it's already was improved for Crohn's disease. And so now that we have this therapy, we've got this ability to block just IL-23, and that's giving us a goal towards more precise medicine treatment, precision medicine.
Perfect. I really love that background. Now, let's talk about the study itself, the patients, the intervention, the comparators, the outcomes, the conclusions, and then separate the induction study from the maintenance study for us.
Yeah, absolutely. So in the current issue of JAMA, this is a registry trial, phase 3 randomized controlled double-blinded study, and it's really two parts. One is induction, which is the INSPIRE, and the other is a maintenance study, which is COMMAND. And the reason why it's important to have two different randomized controlled studies goes back to the comment I made earlier about the goal of treatment. Number one, you want to be able to induce remission. And amongst people where a drug does induce remission, we then want to maintain that remission, meaning we don't want the disease to come back. And that's really the two parts of this two-part randomized controlled study. So the primary outcome is clinical remission. And one of the things that we've seen with the evolution of randomized control studies for ulcerative colitis is far stricter kind of rules around what we define our primary outcome. Historically, if you go back 20 years ago, we just wanted to see a patient response to a therapy. But now we have a more rigorous definition of clinical remission, and it also encompasses endoscopic disease activity to show that we're not only making people feel better, but also that their endoscopy improves when we scope them before and after treatment period. And so the INSPIRE was the induction study, and it essentially showed that 20% of those receiving 1200 milligrams of intravenous risankizumab at week 0, 4, and 8 achieved clinical remission at week 12, compared to only 6% of placebo. And one of the key things we've done by having these really strict criteria is it really started to like lower the placebo response rate, which historically was much higher in previous randomized control studies that used less strict criteria. Now, the COMMAND maintenance randomized trial, what it did was it took people who responded, so it didn't have to be in remission, they just had to show a response to the therapy at week 12, and then they randomized them to either receiving 180 milligrams or 360 milligrams of risankizumab or placebo, which essentially is withdrawal of risankizumab. So the people had received the induction and then they got a placebo. And so then essentially didn't get any therapy going forward, and they followed them out to 52 weeks. And the dosing of maintenance is every 8 weeks. And again, what they showed in the randomized control study is that when they looked at people at 52 weeks later, both the 180 milligram and the 360 milligram people had a significantly higher outcome of remission, both clinical and endoscopic, at week 52 compared to placebo. And then, you know, when they looked at serious adverse events, it was actually less common in the UC-treated patients, but in part that was driven by the fact that people who went on to get placebo, most of their adverse events were worsening of their ulcerative colitis, which was not unexpected given that they were on placebo. But really importantly, that we didn't see any new adverse event signals. You know, the things that we saw in this study were common to other IL-23 inhibitor studies that were done in the past. So no new signals from an adverse events perspective.
Great. Thank you. And so the conclusions that risankizumab is significantly better than placebo for induction and maintenance and ulcerative colitis. Where does that put risankizumab and then armamentarium of so many different drugs for the management of this disease?
Yeah, it's such a great question. I mean, as you nicely stated, the conclusion of the study is, again, we have another drug. This adds another drug to a growing list of biologics and oral small molecules that have proven efficacy and safety in treating moderate to severe disease when we compare it to placebo. And really the challenge that we as gastroenterologists now face is how do we sequence these therapies against each other? Meaning, you know, which advanced therapy do we use first? Which one do we use second line and so on? And this is really important consideration because there is some emerging evidence that suggests that people with UC respond best to their first line agent. And so we really do want to make that right decision up front. And that choice of, you know, do we use an IL-23 inhibitor, an anti-TNF, an oral small molecule as the first, second, or third line therapy, you know, there's a number of different factors that both physicians and patients are taking into consideration. Some of them are clinical factors. So, for example, IL-23 inhibitors were originally shown to treat psoriasis extremely effectively. And so if you have somebody with psoriasis or developed psoriasis on anti-TNF, which can happen in some of our patients, IL-23 inhibitors is actually a really good drug to kind of pivot to. Then the other thing that we do is a lot of our first-line treatments for moderate to severe has historically been anti-TNF therapies. And if you look back at the last 20 years of anti-TNF therapy in the treatment of both Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis, you know, these are very commonly used drugs in this setting. In fact, they're now biosimilar options, which makes them a less expensive option. And so now we're starting to look at, you know, what are the best treatments post-anti-TNF? And there is some data coming out to suggest that using an IL-23 inhibitor in those who have lost response to anti-TNF is actually an effective second-line therapy as well. And so these are really important questions. The other really important question that we have is, you know, we have ustekinumab, which is the precursor to risankizumab and to mirankizumab. Should we be using ustekinumab first or should we be using risankizumab second? And this is also a very important decision that we're facing and struggling with right now as well.
That's really important. And it does give rise to the questions about step up versus step down therapy. And what you've kind of illustrated here, you never get another chance at a first line induction. And that kind of the first drug you use is the most important decision you make. And so one of the things that comes up is, you know, gosh, 20% response within the induction. Wow, that seems like a lot of room to be moved in terms of improving the management of ulcerative colitis. So where do we got to go from here? I mean, again, is my initial perception that 20% isn't a whole lot, is that well-founded? Or again, what is your response to that and where we need to go with this whole field?
Yeah, and in part, you know, historically what's happened with randomized control studies in both Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis is that we've had less stringent criteria for our primary outcomes, and that's led to high placebo rates. And then what we've discovered is as we become more rigorous with our definitions, both with clinical definitions as well as endoscopic definitions, in fact, some of our secondary outcomes are now looking at histological definitions of remission as well. As we become more strict about those criteria, we actually create a better separation from placebo. And I think that's kind of led to, for example, a clinical remission of 20% for induction seems low, but it's based on a very rigorous definition of a response. If you look at the secondary outcomes that kind of loosen up those factors, they actually do better than 20%. The big thing for induction is we recognize that we may not necessarily get everyone in complete remission within kind of an 8 to 12 week window. So when you looked at the people who went on to the maintenance arm, those who responded with their criteria didn't have to be strict remission. And so that's a much higher group of the cohort. And then it also gives those people a longer chance to then respond. But ultimately, going back to your original question is, even in the best of settings, we know that whether it's an IL-23 inhibitor, a JAK inhibitor, anti-TNF, not everybody who is given a therapy is going to respond perfectly. And some people, they're what we call primary non-responders. They don't respond at all. First one, some are secondary non-responders where they initially respond and they lose that response within months or years following treatment start. And so really where we start thinking about the goals, where do we go next? It's really around precision medicine. It's around developing biomarkers to tell us who are the right people who have ulcerative colitis that should get an anti-TNF as a first line versus an IL-23 versus a JAK inhibitor. Who are the people who don't respond to X and therefore they have a biomarker that tells us, you know, we should do Y next. And that's where a tremendous amount of research is going right now in the field of ulcerative colitis is to try to identify what are those kind of genetic, serological, disease-related biomarkers that can tell us who should we treat with what drugs going forward with ulcerative colitis.
Well, Gil, thanks so much for your insight and your comments and your editorial about this paper really provide a wonderful background, but also the important perspective about the current state of management of patients with ulcerative colitis, and also really do highlight the importance of finding new drugs to help people with this refractory disease, as well as tailor management and determine which drugs to use in which patients. So thank you very much for your time and your expertise. And I really do expect that these comments really do help us understand much more about the management of patients with ulcerative colitis.
Thank you so much for the opportunity to talk to you today, too. Thank you.
I'm John Inadomi, and I've been speaking with Dr. Gil Kaplan about a randomized clinical trial of risankizumab for induction and maintenance in patients with moderate to severe ulcerative colitis by Lewis and others. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. Thanks for listening.